Peter Ilyich Tchaikovsky was born in Votinsk, a small provincial town in Russia, in the year 1840. Already at the age of six, this shy, moody, sensitive boy found happy release not in childish games, but in music, especially the music of Mozart, whom he idolized. The boy was so obsessed with music that his mother worried over his health, and so a new French governess was introduced to the household.
Alexandra, Pierre, Nicolas, enchanté. What a nice home you have. It will be a pleasure to work here.
Oh, thank you.
Merci. I have a lot to learn from you, Pierre. You see, I know so little about music, and you know so much.
It was love at first sight, even though Mademoiselle never did learn very much about music.
Pierre, in winter it was all right to spend so much time at the piano.
That's what I like to do best, Mademoiselle.
I am responsible for your health, so you will go out in the sunshine and play now. Oui?
Please, Mademoiselle.
Mm-mm. Besides, we have to get the house ready. Major Mashovksy is coming to visit your parents.
Major Mashovksy?
Mm-hmm. And you know it. Come on.
Peter's heart was pounding with the excitement of this great moment. Major Mashovksy was a pianist of some renown, and pleasing him, receiving his approval, was a pressing need for the boy.
Peter Ilyich. Chopin himself couldn't have done better at your age.
Oh, someday you will be a great pianist, huh?
Greater than Mashovksy. But don't let praise go to your head, my boy. That's bad.
Pierre, to bed.
Whenever the boy's soul was stirred, the music would throb in his head until it was almost painful.
What is the matter, Pierre? Oh, your head is burning.
The music, it's in here. It won't let me sleep.
Oh, mon chéri. Oh, Pierrot, my little Pierrot. It was a mistake to let you play. Music always upset you. I know something that will make you sleep. Here's a story you have not heard before. La Belle au Bois Dormant. The story of the Sleeping Beauty. Once upon a time, there lived a king and a queen who were sorrowly grieved because they had no children. And then one day, a little princess was born. They named her Aurora. At the christening party, her three good godmothers bestowed on her three gifts. But the spiteful godmother, who had not been invited, decreed that a little princess should prick a finger on a spinning wheel and die.
No, the story wasn't putting him to sleep at all. On the contrary, it stimulated his musical imagination, and slowly, the little fairy tale was taking melodic shape in the boy's mind.
Thank you.
out with you in the fresh air. And no more piano until you do.
A keyboard may be locked up, to be sure. But how does one shut off a melody that hammers in the brain? Peter could hear it, feel it in his very fingertips. The spirited march of a mighty procession, moving toward the king's castle to hail the birth of Princess Aurora. He was allowed to play again to his heart's content. But contentment was never to be Peter's fate for long. Soon he was to suffer the heaviest blow of his young life. His parents decided to prepare him for a government career at school in St. Petersburg.
Someday you will be a high civil officer like your papa. Think of it.
But I don't want to be a high civil officer. I want to go back home with you.
Be a good boy, study hard. I know I will be proud of you, darling.
The little boy never saw his mother again. A short time later, she was dead. A blow so crushing that his musical genius withdrew deep inside of him. It went to sleep like Sleeping Beauty in the fairy tale. And strange to say, like Sleeping Beauty, it was to stay dormant for a long time before something wonderful happened to awaken it again. 17 years went by inside the gloomy Imperial Ministry of Justice at St. Petersburg. Peter Tchaikovsky, now 23, toiled as a lowly copy clerk. A light had gone out in him, the divine light of music. He felt empty and oppressed. His life, his work, seemed quite without meaning. But the time for awakening had come. The new Conservatory of Music was opening under the great teacher and composer, Anton Rubinstein. It was a momentous event in the musical life of the capital, and it hit Peter like a thunderbolt. Suddenly, he knew exactly what he must do. He decided to be among the first students to enroll in the evening class for piano and composition. With tremendous enthusiasm, he threw himself into his studies. After his lessons, Peter's genius for melodic invention would make him improvise tunes of his own. It was on such an occasion that he first met the great master Rubinstein.
You have talent, young man. But why this terrible basso ostinato? Why not like this?
Well?
Well, it seemed like a good idea, sir, at the time.
You're going to make music your career?
I have dreamed of it, maestro, but I have to earn my bread.
Bread? Did Bach, Mozart, Beethoven think of bread? For music, an artist must be willing to starve.
But those men had genius, maestro.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not even sure I have talent.
You doubt the word of Anton Rubinstein? Well, there's a way of finding out. Here is a theme. Remember it.
Write me some variations on it. Oh, and another thing. In composing variations, not only quality, but quantity counts.
Peter worked all night without let-up. And next morning at the office, he kept on writing down the never-ending stream of musical ideas that clamored for expression.
The official decree with the signature of the Prime Minister. Variations on a theme by Anton Rubinstein by Pete Illich.
I'm awfully sorry, sir.
You're sorry? You're sorry? You go and tell His Excellency the Prime Minister that you are sorry, so he can go to His Imperial Majesty the Tsar and tell him that he is sorry.
But I did.
Get out. You are dismissed. This instant, you are dismissed. Get out, 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 out.
What is it? What is it? Can't you see I'm busy?
But, Maestro, the variations. You gave me a test theme yesterday, remember?
Yeah. Well, put them down here. I'll look them over later.
Yes, sir.
Variation number 215. 215. Possible. Mr. Tchaikovsky, please. Come on. Tell me, you wrote all these since yesterday?
Well, you said quantity counts, Master, so I...
Yes, I expected about a dozen, but this?
Oh, they are... Very bad.
Bad? No, they're not bad at all. In fact, some of them are quite good. Rubinstein is always right. You have a talent, Tchaikovsky. Will you put yourself into my hands?
Will I? Well, as a matter of fact, I have no choice. I quit my position with the government. They caught me writing those.
Then you are willing to starve for music. Good.
But the full awakening of Peter's musical genius came the day an Italian opera company arrived. It was not so much because of the opera, but because of a certain beautiful prima donna, Desiree Artot. Was in love. He knew that all the eligible males of St. Petersburg were at the feet of the divine soprano. He was poor, but he could give her something even a Grand Duke couldn't match, a song.
Come in.
I beg your pardon, Mademoiselle. Peter Tchaikovsky. Mademoiselle was kind enough to ask me to...
But yes, the young composer. What a lovely song, the most beautiful gift I ever received.
Mademoiselle was the song. I merely wrote it down.
You are a poet in words too, Monsieur Tchaikovsky. How can I ever thank you for dedicating your beautiful song to me?
By singing it for me. Mademoiselle, I've kept you.
It will give me pleasure to see you again, monsieur.
A flood of melodies now poured from his busy pen, and soon Peter and Desiree were engaged to be married. Secretly, he went to work on an opera. It was to be a surprise gift for his beloved.
For you, Mr. Tchaikovsky.
My dearest friend, I know you will find it in your heart to forgive me and to wish me luck. I have married a singer of my opera troupe, a fine man. I am sure you will become good friends.
Hurt and embittered, he vowed that he would never write another note of music. But his genius was too strong now. Never again could it be crushed like the paper model of an opera stage. Time had healed the wound in his heart. Peter had even grown a beard to dignify his status as a composer. In place of the lost Desiree, a new love had taken over. The ballet. It was an art ideally suited to Peter's talents. His first ballet was called Swan Lake, and Peter had great hopes for its success.
Thank you.
The audience was deaf to this fresh new voice in the realm of music. Swan Lake was a dismal failure.
Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake repels public at premiere. We predict this was its first and last performance. Anywhere.
Peter had always been helpless in the face of disapproval. And now he wanted to run away, flee the oppressive atmosphere of criticism and misunderstanding. He decided to go on a long trip. Someone had sent him a story idea for another ballet. He didn't realize then that the peace of his mind was in this manuscript and not in his desperate flight. Peter found no solace in the capitals of Europe. He was blind to the sights and heard only the nagging voices of his critics. At Naples, Peter took a steamer for the voyage home. And one stormy night, he had a strange dream.
The music. It's in here. Oh, let me rest.
I know something that will make you sleep. The story of the Sleeping Beauty. Once upon a time, there lived a king and a queen who were sorely grieved because they had no children. And then one day, a little princess was born. They named her Aurora.
Cloud passing, the confusion in his mind cleared away. He suddenly recalled the manuscript he had taken along without knowing why. All through the long journey, Peter had suppressed the music that was crying in his soul. But his strange dream had broken the dam. In a mighty rush, the pent-up melodies, even those he had composed as a little boy, burst forth into the open. And so Peter forgot all about the storm, about his past failures and defeats. And before he reached home, the entire score of Sleeping Beauty was completed. And this time his creation was headed for the bright future that was in store for all his wonderful works. Thank you.